Do we have to have a...
We have to keep the pace, you know? Because we're going to put music. Like, welcome to the Husky Rate Podcast. My name is Kyle. We share our gamer tags, too? I assume. I guess we should.
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Yeah.
We need to open this in some way.
Hey. That's the opening. Uh-huh. Right? Hey, welcome.
Welcome
to the Husky Raid inaugural.
To the Husky Raid podcast.
Perfect.
That
perfect.
Was great.
I like it.
The inaugural. The
theme
first
song
one.
Insert here. Now we just wait a little bit.
Husky Raid podcast. Husky Raid podcast.
Perfect. Perfect. Right. I love it. I love it.
There it is.
So yeah, let's go around the table, introduce ourselves. My name is Tyler.
He needs the introductions more than the other two.
I truly do. I've been in very little Husky Raid.
You
things.
Know Tyler as the voice of the astronaut.
The astronaut.
Episode
that
eight of yep, Destiny yep. Cups. And
my it's probably the best line ever. It's probably. Got the most character.
It does. Yeah,
we did just, build a very big backstory.
Oh, there's a huge backstory. Yeah. If people could only read the scripts.
Bigger than J-Lo's backstory. That's how big the backstory is.
yeah. Hip reference. Something along the lines of amateurs.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, ooh. You can just feel the passion.
Being in the room with it was a whole other level.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it was wild.
I'm just sorry, to see it. But I'm taking up way too much time. I'm taking my Xbox One gamer tag is Mr. A, and that is A Y Y Y.
Send him friend requests instead of us, please.
Yeah, you don't. Yeah. You can
talk to him.
Only one person has ever sent me anything, and it was, I've seen you in videos. Can I be in videos?
That was the thing. That was it.
Classic.
That was it.
Yeah.
That's a great.
Yeah.
All right.
Moving around.
I guess I'm next. I'm Scott. Xbox One gamer tag Mega Magwitch. You know me as the writer of Destiny Cops and the voice of forgettable characters. Also the
of dead characters.
Yeah, a lot
characters
of
that just die.
Dead and well, the rookie did die, but kind of. He was alive still.
He's still alive.
He's
right?
out there somewhere.
I assumed he was still alive.
Yeah.
I'm not the writer.
I assumed
so
he was dead.
Oh, okay, perfect.
I thought he was dead. Season 2 is just gonna be him, right?
They said they were going to get the med kit when he died.
Yeah,
whatever,
so they wouldn't get the med kit if he was fine. Dying. They'd just inject him with morphine right there and let him
just fade out. It's a very dark show.
It really is. It really is.
But I also voice Dan, and I just, you know, I don't want to do it.
You don't want to do the voice. I don't want to. Dan's supposed, he'll be a special guest sometime.
Yeah.
On
the show.
I hope so.
Oh, let me do the Dan.
Yeah.
Yeah!
That's, and then Kyle fixes it all in post, but that's how I record it.
The whole thing. It's done in childish voices.
Yeah.
Yeah!
Everything.
Let's blow him up!
Everything is done post-production for that show.
There
is no production, really. It's
no.
all post.
It's all in post, yes.
We don't actually film in Destiny Cops. I do it on a computer. I edit it, so it looks like
it's all computer animated.
It's
by
CGI.
Oh,
yeah.
It's great. That's why, you know, it takes a while.
I don't know why we choose to have the gun in some of the shots while he animated it that way.
Well,
but
the fact is that you guys have a development kit. And so you're just able to move everything around.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
Bungie was really,
you know,
nice,
like,
to send you that.
You know, in Sonic 2, there's debug mode code. We do that. We input that.
It's all. It is the same code.
Yeah,
actually.
It's exactly
go
the
home,
same. It's crazy.
Go home and try it. It's the same code.
Yeah, we'd tell you it, but that'd be, look it up on cheatcodes.com.
Yeah, it's the Konami code in Destiny is really cool. If you can use that.
Yeah, it's great.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
All right. We should probably move on.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Certainly.
Well,
Kyle.
My name's, I'm Kyle Davidson. I'm the Boisterous Bitty character. You know me as Tragus, probably. And I do that. I edit some episodes and do some audio stuff for the episodes and shoot the camera sometimes. But yeah, that's my role with it.
He does everything.
He does. He's the heart and soul.
Heart and soul.
Husky Raid.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
So yeah, Husky Raid podcast.
Podcast.
The inaugural episode.
The inaugural. Our point is, what's our goal here? We're recording things not only about Destiny, but about video games in general, branching out with the Husky Raid brand.
All kinds of nerdy
all kinds
news,
of,
probably.
Yeah. Our goal is to have video up eventually. technical difficulties.
We didn't actually have any proper plans for it today.
Yeah, so we're sitting here in our pajamas drinking our coffee. It's early, but yeah. So
mostly video game news, but also heavy politics.
Let's talk about the election rigging at the DNC.
That's all I want to hear about. Yeah. Honestly, that's all I want to talk about. I'm glad someone brought it up.
I'm glad we're finally talking about Hill Liar.
Donald Rump.
Make Donald Trump again.
Oh, come on. Yes. I'm livid. Livid. Absolutely livid.
Yeah.
But yeah, we've got a few things to talk about today. We've got some Destiny Cops news to bring you. We've got, we're going to talk a little bit about where Destiny's going here in September and maybe
September
some thoughts.
Ends.
And maybe some thoughts on Destiny 2. And our big topic today is talking about Pokemon Go. Everyone's talking about it, so certainly we want to touch on it. And things are changing. It's in the news. It's in the news today. I mean, just this morning, London players robbed of phones at gunpoint while playing Pokemon Go. So we'll talk a little bit about that.
Well, that's how you play, right?
You're supposed to steal other people's phones to get their Pokemon.
I assumed. Yeah. I mean, this is Team Rocket here. We're not.
Yeah.
You're not playing nice.
Yeah.
Playing
to win.
Ash was a little bit of a baby. I mean,
the theme song is I Want to Be the Very Best.
The very best.
Yeah.
And the only way to do that is to take out the competition.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Certainly agree.
And, kids are in, because, Ash was only 10 years old when he left home to become Pokemon
trainer. Pretty messed up.
Kids need to be. Yeah, I mean, you'd be thrown in this world a lot earlier.
Yeah, and so we're just, we're Team Rocket. We're stealing their Pokemon. And just,
Yeah.
Just run up to kids, grab their phone, throw it on the ground. How would you steal their Pokemon? You'd need their Gmail.
Well, once they eventually introduce trading.
Trading. You just
can
send
steal
it to
their phone and then trade over.
Because now we just break their phones in front of them.
Yeah, exactly. Just so they know their Pokemon are
laugh.
Dead.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, real Team Rocket style.
Yeah.
Real Team Rocket style. Not as though
I can't
there's
tell
any sort
you
of backup.
How many Pikachus I've killed to make kids cry. It's crazy.
You just grab them, transfer all of them.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, there's no better joy in the world.
Yeah.
Watching a kid transfer his Vaporeon.
That's what you need, too. Vaporeon.
I know. Well, tier. and that's one of the pieces of news I want to talk about today.
But first, should we start with...
Let's start with things? Destiny Cops news. Kyle, what do we have on the front of Destiny Cops?
Well, yeah, so we got plans for the release of the finale of Destiny Cops.
Yippee!
It's awesome. Usually we just finish it and get it out as quick as we can, which we're doing, but...
which we're still doing,
we're
don't
still
worry.
Doing.
We're not withholding... Yeah.
But, it's a two-part finale, so just like,
Hunger Games.
Hunger Games, Harry Potter, you got...
Divergent.
All the best things, Twilight, you always got to split it up.
Split them up. Oh,
it's going to be in movie theaters like... Those
yeah,
movies.
If it's not playing, make sure to talk to the people at your local theater.
Yeah,
bring
certainly
it up,
bring it up. Not like the what is it, Divergent series, which is going straight to
TV,
straight to DVD,
is
straight
it?
To TV.
Yeah,
the season or the ending instead of them putting out the movies like they have been.
The finale movie of this thing is going to be a TV movie.
Well, at least they're finishing it, I guess, for the 10 fans that went and saw the movie.
Seriously, yeah. So anyways, Destiny Cops, this Tuesday is part one of the finale.
Ooh, yes.
Part one's coming out on Tuesday, and then the following Tuesday, part two will be out. But there's a cool thing. If you want to get an early release of part two of the finale.
How do I do that, Kyle?
Well, let me tell you. Monday night, we are going to stream, and we were thinking, it'd be fun to rewatch all these episodes, because... it's been a long time since we've watched some of the first ones.
I never even watched them, to be honest.
He writes it. He doesn't watch the first project.
It's like Red vs. Blue, right? I mean, that's all. I can just watch Red vs. Blue. You guys are just remaking
it. It's essentially that, yeah.
Okay.
All I do, I watch their episodes, and then I just jot down and change the names.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
So Monday night, we're going to stream all the episodes together. And we're going to watch it and talk about it, commentate behind-the-scenes stuff. A lot of funny things.
This coming Monday? Monday the 1st?
The 8th.
Why can't we do it Monday the 1st now, Kyle? What?
Well, there's a problem with programming. We were going to, but ABC decided to air the finale of The Bachelorette, and, we got to keep our priorities.
Gotta
straight,
have
so
your priorities.
We can't
important.
Do, we can't do the
important.
Stream that night, so we're doing it on before the final episode. which I think is more appropriate anyways.
Definitely.
But we're going to watch all the episodes together and stream them. And at the end of that stream, we're going to give out the link to the episode for part two. So that people on the stream, if you're on the stream, you can watch the finale, the part two episode a whole, you know.
Whole extra day early.
A holy day early.
The holiest of days.
The holiest Destiny of days. Destiny Cops 2.
Yeah, but so this Tuesday, part one will be out, and then the following Monday, we'll do that stream with the release of that episode for an exclusive release, and then the Tuesday the 9th will be the final episode of season one.
Prepare yourself for a disappointing conclusion.
No,
I really hope that this podcast comes out before August 18th.
Won't that be embarrassing? Wow. If it doesn't. No,
yeah. All that buildup, all that conversation.
Well, are we recording this? I thought this was just
this
practice.
This is the rehearsal?
Yeah, rehearsal.
Oh, not recording at all.
No. Yeah, okay, good.
What's on the verge for season two of Destiny Cops? We got anything going there?
There's discussions.
There are discussions.
Can we be privy to any of these discussions?
I don't want to give anything away. We have big plans for episodes that are going to be a lot.
Right here and now, there will be a season two of Destiny Cops.
If all goes well, then yes.
Yeah.
It's planned.
Our plans are ambitious, so it's quite possible that we're not skilled enough to pull them off. But if we can persevere, then there will be.
Right on.
Yep, and it's going to be, I mean, we have plans set out for, you know, plot-wise for multiple
seasons. Oh, yeah, we have it plotted out through season three at least.
So we're not, you know, we have plans for it. It's just executing those plans is difficult.
We want to make sure that we don't repeat our first season's follies of taking a year to release episodes 2 months apart.
Is that a folly?
Yes.
Are
you asking if it was our plan to take over a year to make 10 episodes?
Think about some of the greatest TV shows out there. I mean, how much time? I mean, you should have aired them out of order.
Yeah.
Like Firefly. Come on.
Yeah.
Just aired them in the wrong order.
They didn't even air all the episodes.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
We actually did make like 3 episodes that we didn't air of season one. We're going to release them on the DVD extras.
Okay, good. Good. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
DVD, Blu-ray, HD copy.
Uh-huh. Well, we're going for 4K right away.
4K, yeah, 4K. Of course.
Yeah, of course. We're actually on Betamax mostly, though.
It is releasing on LaserDisc. I mean, come on. We're in space. We should be watching laser videos.
Exactly. It makes a lot of sense.
It makes the most sense.
I think Tragus would have a LaserDisc collection if anybody would. It would be Tragus.
I know. Yeah, I know for a fact that Tragus has a LaserDisc collection.
Oh, good. So, season two, it'll probably happen. And when it does, it'll probably be a while because we want to try to get them all made and all ready for a regular release so that we don't have people constantly complaining about where the next episode is.
Mm-hmm. A lot of complaints? You get a lot of complaints?
I'd say it's 50% of our comments on anything we release.
That makes sense.
Yeah, it's just, when's the next Destiny Cops coming out? When's the next one coming out? And we try as hard as we can to get them out fast, but...
Yeah. But we're not very good at what we do.
We're not good at what we do. So it takes a while. So we want to not do that for season two and have it be awesome with a release schedule.
Yes.
That would be amazing. That's the biggest goal we have.
We're gonna start writing soon. So
now let me... not that this is meant to be any sort of real interview here. I mean, it's a podcast. It's a conversation.
I feel like he's about to drop a bomb. He's
No, I just want to get some thoughts.
Do you have any comment on these pictures?
when your dance videos came out, Husky Raid dance videos, they blew up. There are other Destiny videos out there. Machinima, I believe, is the correct term.
Machinima.
Yes. Machinima. And you guys are not the only ones out there. There are some other ones making some other groups making Machinima. But a lot of people reference you. Did you expect it to blow up in the way it did? And follow up question, why start making Machinima in Destiny of all games?
Oh, geez.
I know, heavy question.
Definitely didn't expect that first episode we had. You know, it blew up fast. So all our episodes, when they were coming out at pseudo regular intervals of like a month, which is not regular.
Very good, but yeah.
But those were getting, you know, tons of views, and it was crazy that we're getting so many views on those.
But the dance videos are even more, like, put those out and then those get a million views all of a sudden. We're just like,
those
what?
Blew up. Certainly.
Yeah, and we love putting those dance videos together, but that's one of those things that we do very rarely. Those are rare releases. If we find the perfect thing that we want to do, and we have a great idea.
It's hard not to repeat yourself in those. Yeah. So we need a great song and great.
Repeat yourself in like dance moves.
Yeah, dance moves and just general ideas, because there's only so many grenades and supers and things like that we can use.
Hard light, those kind of guns that make, you know, have the.
We need lots of fresh ideas for those.
Yeah, and it was like, you know, we'll a dance video, it's kind of up in the air how it will happen, like what will happen with it, because the last one was Backstreet Boys, and the Backstreet Boys, you know, retweeted it and they put it on their Facebook page.
Which
is like crazy.
Yeah.
And so,
why use Destiny? I mean, I think we've seen a lot of Machinima in Destiny. Maybe I would say even Minecraft, you know, things that.
Minecraft,
which is much more of a sandbox type of game. Really, Destiny's not a sandbox game,
the one thing about Destiny that's like the best, like a great video game to do it with, is Destiny has such a community with Reddit, with everyone, you know, the Destiny community. There's nothing else like it in any other video game I've ever played. You know, everyone's in on it. The first year of Destiny was a little rough, but a lot of people stuck around for it because it's a great game. You know, not a whole lot of content.
The core is there as a great game.
And so that first year, you know, lacking content and everything was fine, but like, it built the community because people were starting to do fun things. You know, the machinimas came out because people were playing but not doing new things. So when that happens, you make your own things to put in. And
I think for me, the reason I enjoy making content in Destiny is sort of the art from adversity mindset, where because there's less tools and it's harder to do it, it feels like a bigger accomplishment to make something impressive in it.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Halo, we could play Halo 5 and have the unlimited sandbox of Forge in there where you can apparently just literally do anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah. But then it'd be like too easy. We need limitations to funnel the artistic expression, as people say. It's kind of like Buffy season 8 in the comics. It really got away from Joss Whedon.
Deep cut right there.
Yeah, but that theory, you know, it's the same for like, you know, I look at Vine. When Vine was like, you know, when people were really into it, it was just 6 seconds. You have 6 seconds. You have to hold the screen. You can do, and now you can just upload whatever you want to it.
It's not cool anymore.
Yeah, it's not. People with better equipment with editing software can really, you know, hammer these vines home. And so.
Yeah, it used to be you wanted to make a stop motion video. You had to tap the screen.
Yeah.
At regular intervals and do your stop motion that way. Mm-hmm. And everything. You screwed up. You had to start at the beginning.
We should do a stop motion episode of Destiny Cop.
Oh my goodness. Wow.
They're all stop motion. We just take pictures every 30 pictures every second. Stop motion.
Well, that new movie, Kubo, you know.
That one looks great.
Yeah, it looks awesome, but it
looks fantastic.
It takes a week to do 3 seconds of that movie. It takes them a week of moving things around. That sounds horrible. Ugh. Who would get into that life? Not me.
Yeah.
That would.
But it's worth it. I mean, because those movies always do so well financially, and those people are so rich, clearly.
Yeah. It's so cool. Yeah.
It is cool.
Yeah.
It's a shame that it's not more appreciated.
Right?
I wish the older stop motion, you know, the claymation, you know, the things that we a lot of us grew up on, you know, just the amount of effort that went into that, and it kind of went out the window. With the computer age.
Yeah, CGI made it so you could just do tons of cool stuff.
Do everything.
They wanted to waste their time with. I miss animation like that, like stop motion and hand drawn. I miss, but you know, but that's why I think that's kind of the reason I prefer television. Is television has tons of great hand drawn animation now.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You guys mentioning the community of Destiny reminded me of something I recently saw on Destiny the game, the subreddit. September 19th. Have you guys heard about this? September 19th, they want to do a DTG, Destiny the Game, make ourselves known in game September 19th. Mm-hmm. Everyone, let's see, on September 19th, equip the Glowhu shader, or if you really can't be bothered to get it, Aurora Blur, and the Sign of the Finite emblem when you load into Destiny.
Ah, yes. Everyone knows that emblem.
Which emblem is that?
It's mentioned on here.
I bet they have a picture of it, though.
It does tell you how to get it, where to get it, where we're going to be teaming up. I mean, it's a very, very long
post. In-game meetup for people who want to be removed from society, but still part of
society.
Yeah, and
this was posted by Mr. Gorgon. So username Mr.
Gorgon's
Gaze. Gorgon's Gaze.
Yeah, I love it. But yeah, just so that as we're playing, I guess, in Crucible and running strikes, that people who get on Destiny the game, the subreddit, can kind of recognize each other. It tells you how to get Glowhoo if you don't have it. It tells you where to...
If you don't have Glowhoo.
Come on. Yeah. Come on. Even I have it.
You don't even deserve to be a part of this community.
But there is an alternate. If you don't have Glowhoo, you can equip Aurora Blur, which I guess you can get from Evil Avante.
Nice.
And then Sign of the Finite is actually one of the free codes. That's one of the Bungie codes. So it's open to everyone.
That's awesome. That's a cool idea. I think that's really neat. I mean, the community, that's what I was saying before. The community of Destiny, it's like nothing else where you can say, hey, let's just all equip the same shader, and then you'll go into game. I imagine going to the tower that day and seeing people running around with that shader and stuff. And
I'd like to suggest that instead of that shader, everybody do a 30-minute pumpkin dance.
Yes,
everybody throw on your pumpkin head.
I think that'd be wonderful too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, Destiny does a lot for the community. I mean, having things like Valentine's Day, Halloween, but a lot of people will take that. Let's use the word, take it salty, right? And they instead decide, well, there's no content, so Destiny's just trying to, resurface and remap things that we already have. How do you guys feel about that? I mean, you guys, I think a lot of us, you guys are the ones who got me into Destiny. You actually made me buy not one, but two consoles to play the game. and so I love it, but I try to avoid a lot of the posts, especially on the subreddits that are just, ireful and
there
full of
anger.
There
can be some vitriol.
Oh my goodness.
There.
A lot of vitriol. Great word. A lot of vitriol.
Thank you. That happens anywhere people really care about something.
That's true.
And they love playing it, and then something goes wrong. It's like, they got to complain about it. But the cool thing about Bungie is that they listen and they'll, change things.
That's true. They do. They take more feedback than most companies that I can think of where they'll actually make changes to the game. I can think of certain game we're going to talk about later where,
yeah.
where
they
not.
Don't listen at all.
Well, and there are certainly most of the Bungie staff. I mean, they're very vocal. They tweet things out sometimes before even doing like press conferences and things like that. And that's really cool. They are, I would say, a part of the community that they helm. I mean, it's really cool. So yeah, Destiny the game. If you're not on the subreddit, check it out. I had to dig a little deep. I was hoping the mods would sticky it, but it doesn't look like it. It is mod approved. It is something that has been decided. We'll check it out. Let's move on. Let's talk about some Rise of Iron. Some stuff coming out here in September.
Yes. This is perfect because I know literally nothing about Rise of Iron.
Wonderful.
I don't watch the streams. I like to be surprised by things.
Say, as content creators, the thing that excites us most about Rise of Iron are the new things, the new possibilities that we're going to have. Like with what I'm excited about with Rise of Iron is that it's only going to be on the new consoles. It's only going to be on PS4 and Xbox One, which is, it'll leave some people behind. But really, with those, it's going to be exciting to see how they push this game further. You know, how they make maybe the patrol areas bigger or even add, certain features that would be amazing for us, like custom games, which is confirmed that's going to happen, but,
it will never happen.
That's a pretty lofty goal. I feel
they'll make custom games, but limited to two people, so we can't record.
Yeah, so you can't record. But that's what I'm most excited for, the new possibilities, because, I mean, even new guns, new effects, because, like, we save all the guns that look cool and all the the things. We save those things for different shots in Destiny Cops or whatever we're doing. Dance videos and stuff. So it's really exciting to get new content to see what else we can do with this game.
You guys are very, hey, do you have this helmet? If you don't have this helmet, we need to get it. I mean, you guys are very anal retentive when it comes to picking, bad choice of word. When you come to picking shaders and every little character detail is chosen. Now, is it all legendary equipment? I know some are exotics. Do you have any rares?
I had a character with a blue helmet.
Yeah.
But that character is no more.
His past, RIP.
Rip Guard 2. We'll forever remember.
Don't get sued, Scott. Yeah, I think basically it's if you can find anything that looks cool, we'll save it. It's just usually the things that look cool are legendaries and exotics, and we tend to pick those also because they're things that other people can get. If we need somebody else to hop in and play a character, it's you know more people have this legendary item than are going to have this random blue that I picked up. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and but now since the hood we can shoot without HUD.
Don't patch that out, please, Bungie.
Please do not patch that out. But we don't have to have our gamer tags above our heads, so you can have multiple people playing one character and have it look good. It's not a, the gamer tag isn't changing between shots. And
yeah, which
like
is, can be confusing. That even for when one person's playing multiple characters, like how
exactly,
Kyle is Dan and Tragus, his actual
character.
Yeah. I think part of like the expansion, how we look forward to more things, plays into why we don't get as salty about the cosmetic little things they do on holidays too, because we can get fun items that will look good for us. Like the Halloween masks are great for us.
Oh, those were fantastic.
Yeah.
If you're ever wondering, you know, who spends money on all the emotes and stuff,
it's us.
We're supporting your things. Free DLC this year. We're the ones supporting you.
I bought so many of those Halloween mask packs to try to get the skull.
And you didn't get it.
No,
you?
I got it eventually. Oh, I was fortunate. I think it was Will who didn't end up getting it.
Oh. So we've got Rise of Iron coming out September 20th, 2016. Cool. As you guys mentioned, so cool. Leaving behind what we're now calling legacy platforms, Xbox 360.
You mean scrubs? you mean the get goods?
Do we have? I don't know that we know anyone who's been playing on PS3 or Xbox 360. I would assume it's pretty dead. I mean,
I would think so.
I've heard a game is hard. It's hard to play on those even now because.
Well, I know my my little brother-in-law who's in middle school. He plays on PS3. Like watching him play is like he hits start and takes like forever for the menu and
take like a minute to get the menu to come
up. It's horrible.
And, like if you need to use a heavy ammo synth, I think it takes a while, and I'm on the new console.
Right?
Like, I got to use this synth, you know, or something, and then. But on Legacy, it's like they have to sit there and like it'll pull out check their phone.
Well, that's realistic. I mean, you're in the middle of a firefight.
It's gonna take a while.
You can't pause.
Yeah,
makes sense. To use your ammo synth.
That's really a good game design feature, if anything.
Yeah.
So we're leaving behind, Legacy platforms. I guess that's the term we're using now. Leaving them behind. With how many consoles are coming out, I don't think it's that big of a deal to leave them behind. I know there's going to be
years
some,
into the current generation.
We really are.
Like 10,
it's
more
time.
Than 10 years, right?
Yeah, into the legacy consoles, but the new one, I don't call Xbox One and PS4 next gen because they're current gen.
They're the current gen.
It's been it's been years. Like
someone says next gen, I'm thinking what the new Nintendo or something that's coming out.
Exactly. Ooh, we've got the new PS4, you know, redesigned new Xbox One.
They're coming out with more powerful iterations or whatever.
Is it one of them's gonna do 4K? I can't remember.
One of them does 4K video or 4K gaming. The other one, I can't even remember what's special.
Yeah,
I think it's
they're
just
all,
smaller and
it's
works
so,
better.
I could read one article one day and completely forget because there's just so much news on these new smaller.
I'll be astounded if this console actually runs 4K gaming. By the way, that's gotta be so expensive. A PC that does 4K gaming is expensive if it does it consistently at like 60 frames per second.
Yeah.
That's all I want is 60 frames per second.
Yeah, I'll settle for that because currently we get like 980p on the Xbox One anyway and barely get 60 frames per second on that. So
So we've got those coming out. Rise of Iron, did you guys see the tweet? I think it was last night from CG Barrett that it works for Destiny, I think. Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I mean,
he's a Bungie game director. I'm going to get this right. He tweeted a photo, and it said, "Wouldn't it be cool if class items were affected by shaders again in Rise of Iron?" We thought so too.
Ooh.
And then we've got a couple of hunter hoods, hunter cloaks that do match the shader.
Is it just gonna be though? Like the new ones are the only ones that match.
All I can say is, hopefully, I'm glad we're done shooting all Destiny cops, because if they change the way,
that would screw up.
It would all of a sudden, you
now
know,
all of a sudden the
Tinsel's
shaders
cloak is would look different. Yeah. Every, you know,
that would be a nightmare.
That would be pretty crazy. So
Tinsel's
cloak
kind of matches his shader anyway, though.
That's true. So we're yeah. Safe.
And
so,
Felice doesn't wear a shader, and you don't wear a class item on Tragus, so we wouldn't even be that bad.
It wouldn't be that bad.
But still, it would screw up something. So,
but it is better because that's what people
much
need,
better
you know?
For
yeah.
playing. Yeah.
Well, and I was not. I was a year one player for like 2 months, right before.
Famesies.
Yeah, and so year one players will correct us obviously if we are wrong. But shaders.
Well, Kyle's one.
I'm a year one player.
Shaders
I'm
at
day
one point.
One here.
Shaders at one point affected class items. Right, and then the Taken
yeah,
King
I
came out,
so.
and it messed yeah. with things.
I don't
yeah, thanks, year one player.
Yeah,
I don't know if it. Well, I don't know if they ever did, or if before it was just that class items didn't affect your light, and so people could use whatever they wanted. So
that
it didn't
was
really
nice
matter.
Too, right?
That
was great.
Yeah, when it didn't matter what class item you wore, because you weren't just using your highest light one. So now it's like if the shaders don't affect your class item, but you want to use your highest thing, then you got to change your whole armor around to make it look good.
Yeah.
Yeah, there are certainly class items that I have used or not used because of color coordination.
Mm-hmm. Well, you gotta look on fleek.
On fleek,
you have to be on fleek at all times.
Because the best, you know, the best class item is the Cloak of Tanix, obviously.
Yes,
but there's only a few shaders you can use while
it really is. A lot of blue shaders I've found that look decent. And so if you're running a Hammer Bro,
yeah.
And you want to use the exotic class item there, the one that you're given, the one with
the
shiny
hammer,
armor, which
yeah.
is yellow and red. You can't use any of those blue shaders because it looks so bad. So welcome to Husky Raid Fashion Sense.
Yes. You don't want to show up for the raid and all your friends are making fun of how your shader doesn't match your class item. It's so embarrassing.
I mean, I can't be the only one who sends messages like, "You look great, bro," just to other people when I'm on strikes.
It makes my day.
Take the time. You know, you're fighting the undying mind and you realize, man, that guy looks so good in one of the Taken King. I love the Taken King shaders personally. I think they look so good.
Yeah.
But
a lot of new.
Hey, you look good. You look good in that Autumn Splendor. That's a nice compliment.
Autumn Splendor. Autumn Splendor. It's like I put Splenda in my coffee.
Autumn Splendor. That was a great.
I have been diagnosed with ADHD.
One of the writers of Destiny Cops, everybody.
Officially, Dr. Davidson has been diagnosed with
ADHD. Have you ever heard
ADHD.
A pun and thought, that's a bad pun from those, Destiny Cops? That most likely came
yeah,
from
Yeah, those were Kyle.
So we've got Rise of Iron coming out in September. Now, the last big update was the light movement back in, what was it, April?
Oh,
bumping
the
light
about
up.
The Taken Spring?
Yeah, the Taken
added.
Spring.
Like Challenge of the Elders and all that in there, right? On that
well, that
update,
was, there
was that before?
No, Challenge of the Elders.
Challenge of the Elders.
You're thinking of Prison of Elders.
I was thinking
right?
of Challenge Mode for
oh,
the raid. But
gotcha,
yeah, Challenge
gotcha.
Of Elders, all the... Yeah, the Taken Spring was excellent. You know?
Yeah, and that I would say that certainly... I probably hadn't played for about a month. Maybe hadn't even touched Destiny.
You don't sleep with the game in your bed? I just
I mean,
have it...
Sometimes.
It goes me, I spoon that, and then my wife sleeps in the other bed.
I take
the other bed, yes.
Yeah, I take it with me wherever
bed.
I go, you know. I
just carry
it. Out,
uh-huh.
But I would say the Taken Spring, at least from the Reddit, it brought a lot of people back.
Yeah.
I thought that was a good move. We don't know a whole lot about Rise of Iron. The stream, we saw what the Cosmodrome is going to look like winterized.
Gallarhornized.
Everything's
Gallarhorn
now.
Oh, God.
You got a Galar Sparrow. You're going to get a new Gallarhorn. All of that with your pre-order. So it takes away a little of the... You know, I mean, there was something special about finding Gallarhorn. I never found it.
I never did either.
Never got one.
You got it on Gallarhorn Day?
Yeah, I got it on Gallarhorn
Day. Yeah,
so did I.
So I had a whole week where it was useful.
Yeah, but you... I mean, the people, the players who went out, worked the raid... You know, got the chest and found it. There was something special about it. Here they're just giving it away as a pre-order. I don't know. Personally, I'm not a huge fan of pre-orders that are super, you know, let's take something that everyone loved and now let's just give it to you for free. If you pre-order, and I would say a lot of Destiny players are going to pre-order. So we're going to see a lot of Galar Sparrows. I don't even know what it's called. Gallarhorn looking.
Sparrowhorn? I don't know. I have no idea.
So we're going to see a lot of it. I mean, what do you guys think?
Personally, I'm not a fan of just pre-orders in general. I never I try never to pre-order things if I can help it. Just, I don't like to give someone money before they've proved that they deserve it. I know I'm going to end up buying this, so I'll probably end up pre-ordering it too. Because, I mean, am I just going to not, as somebody who makes videos and I'm not going to, guys, I'm not getting the DLC, yeah. I don't think. You know, let's just keep recording in the old stuff.
We can record in the new Cosmodrome, but we can't because Scott
didn't buy the upgrade.
So we have to do it in Venus again.
So we're just going to keep the whole thing in Venus as usual.
I've been burned on a fair amount of pre-orders. Last one for me was The Division.
Ooh.
I wanted to love that game so much. I pre-ordered it about 2 months out. I wanted to love it and found myself going back to Destiny. And so it's interesting that we you guys hear that buzz too.
Yeah, I know. You? Just you brought it up.
We're going to pause. Technical difficulties, figure out where this buzz is coming from. We will be right back.
Bricka bricka brick. What is making that buzz?
Oh good.
Coffee Cheez-Its?
Yes. Kyle has rejoined us.
Oh, welcome hear anything. Back.
There he is.
Now he could still hear us. He was in the room.
Oh, that's true.
I didn't hear his point, though.
Okay, we have maybe fixed the buzz. If
no,
you can
we
hear it, if you can hear it,
then
sucks to be you.
You're too old if you can
you're
hear it.
You're too old if you can hear it. Young kids. We were talking about pre-orders. They're stupid and poopy. We're going to move on to the main topic of today's podcast. And I think kind of the reason we wanted to make this podcast in the first place. Well, at least Scott and I, and then Kyle said,
we realized we don't have any charisma between the two of us, so we invited Kyle to join.
Yeah, our voices
charisma
are just
Kyle.
Too low, and so I guess
yes.
We need Kyle to brighten our timbre.
Clearly,
we're going to talk about Pokemon Go. Initial thoughts, just round table, initial thoughts.
Pokemon Go!
Pokemon Go.
Well, I just looked, and there was a Beedrill outside nearby on our
that's why
radar,
that's
and
why
I think
buzzing.
That's where the buzz was there. Buzz was because there's a Beedrill buzzing around.
Bees buzz.
I would assume, yes, that was the reason. Now, I am the lowest level of the three of us.
Go ahead and just guess. I'm the highest level right here.
Level 22 are you or something?
Yeah. Making my way toward 23 any day now.
I'm 18. I've been saving up my Weedles and Pidgeys, waiting for that lucky egg to come around.
Yeah.
Dang. I've got to check. I think I'm a level 7.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
I wish I was level 7 again. It's so easy to catch Rattatas.
I know.
Stuff.
So they don't run away. You throw a Pokeball at them now and they're
gone.
I would say
it's
in
a level
all,
28 Rattata, but he can't stay in the Pokeball, you know?
In all at level 7, I think I've had 2 Pokemon run away. Not a lot.
No.
But
you're so young.
But
so
yeah,
young.
Where I live in the suburbs in Indiana, there is not a whole lot around. There's one Pokestop in the neighborhood. So I would say there's one Pokestop within like a half mile radius.
Some people at this table live in a downtown area.
Yeah.
And work at a downtown area where they can sit and get Pokeballs all day long.
Oh, all day long.
Every 5 minutes at my desk.
From the office.
I can't believe it. I cannot.
Getting lunch.
I run out of Pokeballs all the time. I have to put Pokemon on the no throw list.
I have.
There's a couple. Rattata. Obviously,
not,
on the no-throw list. Kakuna, who would think that a Kakuna would be hard to catch? But
Zubat on the
no-throw
list?
Oh, that's been on the no-throw
list.
That was
go
very
for
first. I, first time I tried to catch a Zubat, I was like, nope, not going.
Is it the,
done.
Is it, are you missing? Like, is it a depth, or are they just?
Well, no, they
well,
just.
Zubats, they're impossible to hit.
Well, they really are.
Yeah.
Yeah, Zubats are impossible to hit. I can throw and hit a Rattata, but they're just not worth it because it takes 25 candies to level them up.
Exactly.
And then
but you're the rat lord.
Away. I am the rat lord, but that was back when I had Pokeballs. So
whereas me, I have 4 Pokestops within walking distance of my apartment and 3 gyms.
How many are you still a leader at any of those gyms?
I'm only a leader at one gym. None of the ones by my house. Unfortunately, my Lapras Empire fell. Oh. I am now, but I still hold the one at my workplace. Heavily contested.
Your Lapras Empire was
4 days.
4 days. You held
the gym. Wow,
it was
that's impressive.
Miraculous. I don't know why. I assumed that I was dying, and everybody just agreed to let me hold it. But I don't know.
No, that's
some unspoken Truman Show rule. Nobody's gonna take Scott's gym.
No, it's been interesting. I now level 7. I think I've fought at one gym, maybe 2. But that's, I think, been the big thing is you go to a place that has a gym, maybe because it's a gym, and you play, And you can sometimes tell who else is in the establishment that's playing Pokemon Go.
You mean
Go.
Everybody who's just staring at their phones, staring at tapping their phone, it.
Typing, swiping, yeah. doing all of that. So we do, just so listeners know, we span the gamut of levels, low, middle, high. Mm-hmm. I would say 20, what was it? 20,
22.
22 is pretty high.
I'm up at the point where it gets harder and harder to level up, at least. Like, yeah. It's 100,000 experience for my next level.
Yeah, that's quite a bit.
I heard it's like a, like, to get from 39 to 40 is like a million or something.
Yeah, I heard it was like over a million.
Someone just hit it, right? Just the other day.
Probably cheating. Probably a spoofer.
Oh, of course. Of course.
How else would you be able to do it? I'm not going to walk that far, you know?
No, there's no way. Unless you just don't work, and I guess that's all you do all day, maybe.
Yeah, that's crazy.
So someone's finally hit it. Looking at some news that we've got here, Pokemon Go's Vaporeon has been nerfed.
Good.
There's that word.
Ooh,
nerfed.
My gym's probably gonna fall at
Patricia.
My workplace.
Patricia Hernandez out at Kotaku posted this just about an hour ago.
Wow.
It looks like the water gun has been tweaked.
That's good.
Damn it.
The water gun has been tweaked. Vaporeon will be slightly more balanced in battle. Again, Patricia Hernandez out at Kotaku.
Will they make it so Jolteon could actually beat Vaporeon? Because
that would
make
a lot
sense.
Of sense.
It really would. Now, I would say, yes, that's what I've noticed, is that the elements do not make sense.
No, they don't
That a lot of the you know, kind of crucial things to planning your Pokemon team in the original games are not there.
Yeah, I think it comes down to the fact that it's not turn-based, so even though Jolteon could do more damage in one hit to a Vaporeon, because it's not turn-based, Vaporeon attacks so much faster mm-hmm. that it just
does more damage.
It. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And is this, let me ask, is this what you guys expected from Pokemon Go?
I had no idea what to expect. Those first promos were so cool looking. Like, do you remember like the hike?
Oh,
like
yeah.
You'd,
oh yeah.
Like I remember one shot of a dude like on a mountainside, and you could see like a chart. Like it was obviously just a imagination of the game in real life, but it was just like a Charizard behind a boulder, like coming out, like stuff like that. But you know, I was like, man, this looks fun. I don't know. Hopefully it's cool. And then it came out, and I was like, okay, yeah, this is sweet.
Okay.
You know, like
it's interesting to me. I don't know what I expected of the game. I don't think the game is actually that great, but it's got like that Destiny vibe where it's just like addicting. Like you mm-hmm. just want to keep playing to be the best. What I didn't expect was for it to be like the most popular game ever made immediately.
Yeah,
like,
crazy.
Especially with how limited it is right now. Like it needs more features and things.
Mm-hmm. What kind of features?
I think it needs to have trading and if a more... Shut up, dog.
Oh, man. Someone must be here.
Oh, no. It definitely needs to add in trading or something like that. And I think the ability to train your Pokemon without just having to catch a bunch of them.
Instead,
I want it to be viable that I could use my first Pokemon that I got.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Not like my Bulbasaur that I picked up that's CP14. I would have to spend so much time to level that thing up to the point where
you
I can
know,
actually
like,
use
you,
it.
Have you heard of people who own pets, like dogs or something, and then like their dog will die and they'll get the same dog and name it the same thing? That's how I feel with Pokemon Go. Like my first Pokemon I was naming, and then I was like, oh,
really
I found
dark.
A better.
That got really dark. Do you
so
know
I
people?
Transferred this one to the factory and renamed the new one.
That's what I think. You know,
do people
like,
do that?
What?
They have the same, like, similar
oh, yeah, you've never,
breed.
Yeah.
I have
I know,
never heard
I've
of that.
I've heard of a lot of people. They'll get the same
that
dog, is, name it the same
that's
thing.
Weird.
And then,
that's placing some expectations on your new dog that I don't think are fair.
That's putting more worth in the name.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Than the
what's in a name?
What's in a name? okay.
A Charizard by any other name would burn as hot.
Yeah, I'm gonna agree with Scott here. I think the game just. Maybe it's because of where I live. I don't live in a downtown area where I can play all the time. I don't travel to places that and you know maybe I'm missing out. But it's not that much fun.
Nah.
I at this so the same day that Pokemon Go came out, I turned on. I picked up Pokemon Yellow. It was the only one I could find. I thought I'm gonna try this out.
One.
It's solid.
It's my
solid.
Favorite of the
red.
Games.
I'm a red guy, you know.
I was a red growing up.
Red.
But,
I was red as well. Don't get me wrong. But when yellow came out, it changed my life.
I like what I like about yellow is you can have all three of the original starters and the Pikachu. It's just it's cool. But I picked them up and I had more fun playing yellow than I did Pokemon Go. And I think the big thing for me is it's missing Pokemon Go is missing some of the features that we love about Pokemon. And that is the training, definitely.
Yes.
The training. You take one creature, monster, whatever you want to call it, and you train it up, and it's yours.
That's the that's one of the biggest strengths of Pokemon, the series, because since Gen 3 on the Game Boy Advance, you can catch a Pokemon on that and still have it with you today.
Yeah.
Like,
seriously,
you can raise
awesome.
It
you can trade
for
them up.
So long. So the fact that in this game they're like disposable garbage most of the time is
it really is, and it's a weird element that really isn't addressed. The whole transferring, and we've all seen the comics, the memes, and everything. Oh, you know the new professor.
Professor Willow?
Willow
is,
Willow.
You know, dumping him in some sort of like garbage disposal. It's
to
make the candy. And it's a little weird. It's so passive. It's so we don't know what it means.
With your Pokemon.
Exactly. Yeah. You're going out and you're catching billion Rattatas just to level up one, you know, and you're right. You have to put forth effort to keep the one starter good. Otherwise, you just catch more Bulbasaurs at a higher level when you're a higher level and you get rid of the other one. Mm-hmm. It seems a little odd.
I think we need that training, and we need some better way to interact with the players around you, because people talk so much now about how they're making friends with people through the game. Like, you run into random people, you meet them, and you talk to them. But if there was some way beyond just trading a gym back and
having
forth,
a social aspect in the game,
yes,
would be amazing. It'd be so cool, because that's a big draw. Like, when I'm, you know, living in the suburbs, not having people around and having to drive to Pokey stops, and a lot of them seem like drive-thrus around here because you have to go to one and they're too far apart. But you get to a downtown area like the Indianapolis Canal, you go down there and there it's just full of people, like full of people playing Pokemon, and it's amazing. It's so much fun, and that's a huge draw, I think, for people living in big areas to be able to go out to a spot and hang out and see other people playing the same game that you are. But to have that social aspect would add so much, especially for players who are out in the middle of, you know, nowhere.
Yeah.
You want to connect with people, but
Well, and it changes tourism in a sense. It it's changing the business model. It's, I mean, you have we've had some businesses here in town that have said, you know, at 2 p.m. on Friday, we're going to activate a lure at our business. If you come in and show us that you're playing Pokemon Go, we'll give you, you know, 50 cents off your beverage or whatever it is. I mean, this is changing commerce, and that's really interesting. You look at Niantic, the company behind, you know, working with Nintendo behind Pokemon Go, and their last big game was Ingress.
Mm-hmm.
Ingress did not take off in the same way.
No, it did not.
I know
it laid the foundation for Pokemon Go.
Oh, it certainly did, yeah. And they have a lot of the same stops. I've noticed a lot of the same, you know.
I think
locations.
It's all the locations mapped out from Ingress. They just kind of transferred right over to Pokemon Go. So, and thanks for all your hard work, Ingress players.
Yeah.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, that was, what, 5-6 years ago, I would say.
I'm not sure when it came out, to be honest. I don't know a lot about Ingress. I know I have friends who played it, and they say that Pokemon Go is just kind of a crappier version of it, but...
I mean, you're gonna have those diehard fans, and no, that's exactly what I heard from friends of mine who played Ingress, that, wow, this is exactly the same. Like, it's just a reskin, and I think to an extent, I'm certain it is.
Oh, yeah.
But
that's what Pokemon... People love them for what they look like and
exactly.
What they are, so
exactly.
Smart.
Well, you've got people who never touched a Pokemon game growing up who are now obsessed with this, and that's what they do. It changes, you know, you're going to a new city. The Pokestops might be how you base where you go that day. You know, your tourism and you're walking around. It's going to be interesting to see in the next couple of years what kind of mobile gaming changes.
I know. Yeah. I'm excited to see. I mean, you know that right now all these big gaming network, they're looking into the Pokemon Go type games, like these location based games. Like, it'll be neat to see that kind of thing happen.
I can say myself already, like, how it affects where you visit. I visited Chicago and happened to go onto the Pokemon Go subreddit, and there was a link for like a big meetup in Chicago, so I went to Millennial Park just for that meetup to see what it was going to be like. Thousands of people in carrying banners and flags for their teams, like forming squads, like a huge contest to go out and capture gyms. Whoever holds the most by the end gets a reward. Like, it was insane.
So awesome.
Yeah. The actual, what little social aspect is built in, because that's what you're going to see is people moving to Reddit and people doing using other means of communication to connect with each other, be it a Twitter page, be it, you know, whatever. You're going to see that develop. And if Nintendo, Niantic, someone doesn't pick up on this, they're going to lose a lot. And we've all heard those great things, those, you know, big meetups, people working together. We've heard the bad things, you know, people getting mugged.
Yeah.
But, you know, bad people do bad things.
Yeah, that's going to happen.
It's right. You open it up. Be aware of your surroundings.
It does say. I see that screen all the time.
People weren't waiting for Pokemon Go to come out. How can I mug someone? You know, I need money. How can I do this? And then Pokemon Go came out. That's it. You know,
finally,
those people are going to find ways to do what they, you know, that's the way these people are getting by.
Be it good or bad, people are finding dead bodies. You know, but I think ultimately what's really been cool about it is people are getting out.
Yeah.
People are going out, and kids are getting, I guess we can call it exercise.
It's walking.
Sure, it's
exercise. If you have to walk 5 kilometers to hatch an egg, I'm sure there are people who wouldn't have walked at all that day.
It's a lot of walking.
3 miles. That's pretty.
Yeah,
good.
But there's still a lot of judgment, at least on my own Facebook.
Yeah,
you're out walking, but your head is buried in your phone.
That's better than sitting inside.
Right. My head would be buried in the computer screen if I wasn't.
Yeah.
Out there. I mean, when I'm playing personally, if there's nothing around, I still look around at what's around me. I don't think anybody's walking and just blindly only staring at their phone.
Well, and there are settings to capitalize on that. You can have the battery save on. Mm-hmm. You can put it in your pocket, feel the vibration when something comes near. I mean, it's not as though it's a great interface that demands you to be looking at it 24/7.
Not at all.
And I think that was really wise on Nintendo's part or Niantic's part, whoever made that ultimate decision, is that it's a very kind of early Google map looking overhead.
Oh, yeah.
You've got your character, but that's it. You don't see other characters. You see the stops, but if you get close again, your phone lets you know.
Yeah.
So it's interesting, the social commentary that's really coming out of this. Looking at other news.
Other news
about Pokemon Go. Russian officials think Pokemon Go is evil.
Well, those are Russians.
Well, you are evil, Russia, so.
Unless you're listening to this and you live in Russia, then you're cool.
You're not evil, but.
The big question is, we have Pokemon Go, the creators, talking about, and this is an interview that I'm pulling up again from Kotaku. It was the first thing that came up. But talking about things like PokeRadar, you know, these outside apps, PokeVision.
Like
what are your thoughts on that? I mean, is this a good thing? Should Nintendo be shutting them down?
When PokeVision first came out, I was like, okay, this is taken away from the game. It's like, you know, it's cheating, blah, blah, blah. But then I can't see where Pokemon are right now.
Yeah, currently the game is glitched.
Is glitched. So if I look on and there's a Pokemon nearby, I got to go use this website if I want to have any chance of finding it.
Exactly. With the state that the game is in currently, where the three-step glitch is active, where it always shows things three steps away, there's no built-in method of tracking.
Right.
So I fully support using PokeVision for right now.
Well, and even when it had... this Pokemon is one step away, two step away. Is that helpful?
Oh, yeah, for
it's
sure.
Helpful. I think that was one of the funnest aspects of the game when it first launched, because that's like I caught a Blastoise early on, and I remember I was walking my dog and I see a Blastoise pops up three steps away. So I immediately just start dashing around like a madman in different directions.
Running in and out of traffic. I mean, the things that we're seeing. Yep, you are that iconic
person. I'm that guy dragging my dog around behind me. And when the steps go down, that's one of the most exciting moments of the game.
Yeah,
when it goes from three to two, you're like, oh my God, I'm on the right path. Like,
now, would you want another step, an arrow? Like, it's three steps in that direction.
That's a little too much.
Is that too much?
I think.
Mm-hmm. I think it was great when you could see the paw prints and they worked. Because, like, my story is I think it was a squirrel pop up. And I was sitting in my basement.
Squirrel. That's an actual animal.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Okay, so you saw a Squirtle pop up.
I saw a Squirtle pop up. I was in my basement, and I open up my phone, and you know how sometimes you open up the thing and your dude like runs from one direction, mm-hmm. like if it's GPS is setting. Well, I was in the nearby as soon as I opened it, and I saw my guy run from one direction to where I was, and the steps went up. So I was like, okay, I think this Pokemon is in that direction, this Squirtle, and it was three away. So I got up because I really wanted a Squirtle, you know? So I got up and started walking in that direction, and I found it eventually, and that was awesome. That was so much fun. And right now, you can't do that.
You can't. It's like, now you see something nearby, and you either have no chance of getting it, or you just go on PokeVision and find it that way. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Any other changes that we want? I mean, besides the social aspect, let's talk about that. What would you guys ideally want to see in a social element that is part of the Pokemon Go app?
If you could see some people that were nearby, or like team members on the same team as you that were nearby, maybe, and you could kind of like train battle with them. I think that would be a lot.
That'd be
of fun.
Cool if you could you could make friends in the game and go to them, and then just, you know, how you go to a gym now and you train at the gym.
Mm-hmm.
You could train with a friend and like fight their Pokemon and level your character up. Mm-hmm. Or not your character, but your
the only issue with that might be is that your friend might let you grind off of them.
Yeah,
which could be
very
a concern.
True.
It'd be,
you know, there's a lot of
you can level up so many XP per week with one person, things
that
like
makes
that.
Sense. Yeah. You can only get so much from training as you're going.
That's a crazy thing about games like this. You'd call this an MMO, right? Probably.
It's an MMO, essentially.
Yeah, it's an MMO.
It's like an augmented reality MMO.
Yeah. AR MMO. I would call it an AR MMO.
Yeah.
But that's the issue, and we see this in Destiny all the time. You want to add something cool to the game? Well, how is it going to be balanced, you know?
Exactly.
How are people going to exploit this?
Oh, yeah.
That's how I think about trading. Like, I feel like it's going to be way easier to get all the Pokemon if they add in trading, but I think maybe what they'll do is have some sort of consumable item that you get, and then you can use that to trade. And like once you run out of those items, you can't trade.
Yeah, and it could be expensive. It could be you might have to use a bunch of, is it Stardust? Is that what it is?
Yeah, Stardust.
You'd use a lot of Stardust or something, you know. That could be part of it.
You could even do that with training with a friend, make it so it costs like Stardust to battle with a friend. Mm-hmm. That way you can't just grind it up your Pokemon's level that way.
Have either of you spent money on the app?
Yes, I have, because I don't have Pokeballs ever. I stopped, though. I think I spent less than $5.
I have it on Android, and I do a Google Rewards surveys, and I had $10 built up
in my Google
wallet. So I used that all on Lucky Eggs. And then I also did break down when I was getting tired of my eggs not hatching fast enough and bought some incubators.
Okay.
As well. But yeah.
I mean, do you think there should be more payment options? I mean, the age-old question is it pay to win? Do you guys feel that this game is pay to win?
I don't feel like it is right now, because you're playing to play. At least in my case, I'm buying Pokeballs with my thing. The only thing I've spent money on, because I'm sitting and I haven't been able to get out to these Pokestops, and I haven't gotten enough Pokeballs, so I have to buy some. If a Pokemon comes up, like right now I have zero Pokeballs, but if a Pokemon pops up that I want, and I have some credit there because I've bought some of the coins in the game, I'll probably, if it's a good Pokemon, I'm probably going to cave right then and there and buy some more Pokeballs so I can try and catch it.
I don't think that this game really falls under pay to win, but only because there's not that much competitive aspect. There's not a lot of interplay with other people right now.
No.
It's only just like, I caught this cool Pokemon. Like, there is the aspect if I want to level up so I can get higher level things so I can take gyms, but right now gyms are kind of inconsequential.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And what, I mean, it's a cool element.
Yeah.
But it, just like any video game, what is it to you?
Yeah.
Right. No, I don't. I just completely lost my train of thought where I was going with this.
More Pokemon stories. My favorite one for myself was going to the Dratini Nest, which is tragically no longer a Dratini Nest in the newest update, unfortunately. Here in Fort Wayne, Buckner Park, for anybody who's listening, used to be the spot.
It's lit.
It was lit.
Buckner Park.
But I was there. It was like the first time I went there, and I was looking for a Dratini, and I was trying to use the PokeVision app to find where it was at, but there's no landmarks because I'm in a park. so I can't really tell where it's at, and it seems like it's over in this field area. So I trudged through this tall, waist-high grass up, and then eventually got to like head level grass, and it had just rained, and I was wearing flip-flops.
Oh, oh
I was.
It's worse.
I came out of it completely soaked, looking like an idiot because the Dratini was actually like on the road to the left of me. It was not even in the grass. Did not need to go in the grass at all to get it. So.
Okay, so going places you haven't gone. I think that's something that this app has added. We are pretty fortunate, and I think I would say that this, you know, it happens all over the country. But there, or all over the world, wherever it's been released, there are probably places that people are going that they've never been to, and I think that's awesome.
Definitely.
Just the other day, in one of our chats, it was Pokagon State Park.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Right, 40-ish minutes away.
Mm-hmm.
That it's a.
It was a Bulbasaur nest. I don't know if it still is. I haven't been able to check on Pokevision to look. That's kind of, I do that sometimes. I just look for spots that have lots of the same Pokemon on it on the map.
Yeah.
But I would say all three of us separately have been to Pokagon.
I've been very close to it. My wife's lake is like right by Lake James, which is right by Pokagon.
Okay. So we're all familiar with it, but I would say the three of us have never gone there together.
No, definitely not.
Oh,
so,
no.
So just even the fact that we, you know, hey, let's go and do this, and that's pretty cool. I mean,
make
that's
a trip
something
out of
that,
it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and the Pokemon Go might be the inspiration for it, the catalyst for it.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, we're still gonna go, and we're not gonna be playing Pokemon Go 24/7. Well, maybe
you're not, but I will.
No, battery dies way too fast.
Level 7 won't over
level
there.
7. Jumping around. I found a Rattata.
Yay!
Oh, goodness. I bought a new phone for the game, personally.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
You bought
a
new phone.
I bet it is driving up sales for new cell phones.
It's definitely got to be driving up sales for new battery packs.
Oh, those have got to be going like crazy.
I haven't bought one yet, but I've been thinking about it.
I've been thinking about it, too. Currently, I use a Bluetooth speaker that can charge my phone, and I carry it in my pocket like a giant can speaker and use that and look like a crazy person.
You leave the volume on, too, so you get
that. Everyone can hear the banner. Oh, no. But I went and bought the new phone because I was using a Galaxy S3 for years, and it doesn't technically run Pokemon Go. You had to download it a little bit illicitly, and because of that fact,
Mirror app, right?
Yeah, I got to do the Mirror APK, and then it has a it glitches when you first start the game, and you have to like randomly click in the right spot of like an all green screen, and then it finally lets you through to play.
And that's why you got a new phone.
Yeah, so I bought a new phone because it was the moment that my phone glitched and I didn't get a Snorlax because of it. Because froze.
Yeah, I would have driven straight to
it. I was like, no, I'm done with this. I'm going to get a new phone.
Now, what Pokemon Go really reminds me of is not only Ingress, because I do remember it coming out. It was on one of my phones. But it makes me think of Foursquare, too. You guys remember Foursquare?
Yeah,
you could become the mayor, I think it was, mayor of certain places if you checked in so many times.
Talking about the game with the ball that you bounce in the four squares at recess? Uh-huh.
Yes, it was exactly
ball.
Like
box
that.
Ball.
Box ball.
That was more of a box ball guy than a Foursquare.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
You know.
What kind of games, what kind of things do we want to see with AR MMOs? I'm just going to call them.
Oh, jeez.
MMOs? In the future, what do you want to see?
I want to see Pokemon Go in Destiny, in the game.
Whoa.
I want my character to play Pokemon Go in Destiny.
Kyle, be serious, please.
This is a serious podcast.
This is very serious.
Taking my question and undermining it.
You know what? I've changed my mind about the three paw print glitch. I actually think it's a good thing. I think more apps should have that glitch. For instance, Google Maps, right now, I put in a friend's address, you know, that I want to go to. It takes me right
there. Takes you right there.
Yeah.
But I think it should take me in the vicinity and then give me three paw prints and say, it's somewhere nearby.
Let's call it hot and cold.
Hot and cold, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you're getting warmer.
Warmer.
You're getting warmer. Ooh, you're cold.
Cold.
Siri, tell me how hot I am to this location.
But here's the thing.
I want that to be
that's
a real
how
thing.
It needs to be a real thing.
It should work that way, but I want it to be glitched where it's just always cold.
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 I'm touching the door right now.
Oh,
cold.
Man. Cold. That would be kind of fun. Like a scavenger hunt app.
Yeah.
Well, imagine what I was thinking of with Foursquare and Pokemon Go and games like this. If there was some sort of real world reward or bonus to actually playing the game, because you're using your phone, you're living your life. It's not as though you're picking up a controller and a console and you're separating yourself from reality. You are, I mean, you're augmenting reality.
I was thinking, oh, sorry.
No, so you should have some real world, not consequences is way too negative, but some sort of real world reward system. You check
consequences
in.
Consequences can be positive, Tyler.
I know.
The word
I know.
Just has a connotation of negativity.
You, I was thinking, if you're the leader of the gym at this location, you get 10 cents off your Starbucks drink. You know, let's say it's a Starbucks. I mean, things like that could be really...
That would be cool if businesses offered something like that.
And now there's a reason to take over that gym. Now, you do run the question of would people take that to the next level and become violent or whatever, but I think...
I sometimes feel violent when my gym gets taken now.
I've seen you get violent. I have seen people yell across the room at you for taking their gym.
Look, it's true. That has happened.
Kyle, what were you going to say?
Oh, yeah, well... Back when, so Pokemon Go has some deal with McDonald's, right?
Right, and that should be coming up pretty soon.
Where McDonald's locations
talking.
Will become Pokestops, which is great for health, you know.
That's what you need.
But
kids
I was
have
thinking,
been walking all day, and then you need a Big Mac.
But I was thinking, like, maybe some organizations will, maybe not in Pokemon Go, but this rewards thing would be like, you go collect 10, you know, McDonald's tickets at different locations or something. You could come in and that would be a free quarter pounder with cheese or something, you know.
Like
something.
The app has built in, like, you hit these Pokestops and then you get rewarded with
And maybe that wouldn't
coupon
be
in app.
I was thinking that would be like how maybe some other developers would go about this game. Maybe maybe a game that's like a coupon game or something. And you could do things
what you're saying.
You know, corporations could sign up for it and put different rewards out there, and I don't know. It's just a thought.
Interesting thought. I'd like to see in Pokemon Go, what if they made it so it tracked your steps for the day better, let's say, and you could be like, if I walked 5K today, so if I go to whatever Arby's, I can get a sandwich cheaper, like if I show them that I, like, you could earn coupons for walking more.
Well, and I think that's specifically what the Pokemon Go watch is going to be, is essentially a pedometer that tracks what you're doing without draining your battery as much, so that when you pull it, it'd be, I assume it's going to be cloud based. I've really not looked much into the Pokemon Go watch accessory just because it keeps getting delayed.
It does,
getting pushed back,
which is a mistake.
It really is. This is how people, or how Nintendo is going to capitalize, because it's not priced very high. They're talking about around $35 for essentially a pedometer that syncs. It's got to be Bluetooth sync to your phone.
You would think, yeah.
And that, whatever, however it works, but that would allow you to walk without draining your phone battery. And that's going to get so many people out more, because you don't need to be looking at your phone to be watching your mile or your kilometers, things like that.
I wish they had something like that that didn't necessarily sync to my phone, but sync to my account, my Pokemon Go account, and then it just tracked my steps, and when I turned on my game and synced it back to my iPhone, it would then like count it toward my eggs and stuff like
that.
Right, that would be cool.
Well, what I'm seeing, and this comes from GameSpot, Tamur Hussein posted this a few days ago. This was specifically an article about the delay. Pokemon Go Plus, it will be what the watch is called, is a Bluetooth device that connects to your phone and offers notifications, vibrations, and LEDs about various things. So near a Pokestop, if there's Pokemon, if there's a Pokemon waiting to be caught, you can simply press a button on the watch to throw a Pokeball.
Oh.
Ooh.
Now,
how does that work?
Now I'm imagining you holding the watch up, your phone up to see the Pokemon, and pressing it, and you guys can see this, but our viewers, our listeners can't. It's going to look very
Tyler
weird.
Tyler took his pants off.
It's very weird. This
there, but
the
yeah.
functionality of this Pokemon watch.
Why are you wearing the watch there, Tyler?
Why are you wearing the watch? I want to be able to throw a fake Pokeball. Can I have that option?
Like, what if they made it like a yo-yo, like a string thing that you could throw and then pull it back towards your hand.
And
that
if there's, you know...
You
yeah.
know you would pelt people with that thing
if
all the time.
If someone's standing in front of you, it's you know...
Sorry, I had to catch it.
You have to do what you gotta do.
You gotta, if you want to be the very best. Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh.
But it'll be interesting, because I agree. I think the Pokemon Go watch, the delay, it's got to be a technical delay.
Do you think that will have a setting that you can determine what it notifies you for? Because, like, currently I have an app on my phone that I use that notifies me when certain Pokemon are within my range. Mm-hmm. And for that, I can set it so, like, it doesn't bother me with Rattatas. I know there's Rattatas and Pidgeys.
What app is that?
I think it's called Pokemon Detector.
Well.
Pokemon Detector, getting a little shout out.
Yeah, which is that one is Android exclusive, probably. I don't know. I don't have an iPhone. I know there's
time to buy an Android.
We need two phones.
No. I know there's an iPhone equivalent that somebody at work told me about, and I cannot remember the name. I will try to find out for you guys, but not for the people listening.
My question
is, I would
like,
hope
with the different notifications, like if there's, let's say, a Pikachu pops up, will it shock me?
Yes. If you step on a Pikachu, it will react negatively.
It has a little built-in squirt gun. If there's a Squirtle nearby,
just everything. Everything is built in. You're getting rocks thrown at you when the Onix shows up.
Well, I get rocks thrown at me.
Anyway. Just on a general basis. Yes. I would hope that there would be some notification settings. Do not alert me for, you know, CP that's lower than this.
I don't want Rattatas every 2 seconds vibrating on my wrist, you know?
Yeah. It'll be, and it's probably these questions and the feedback from players
that caused the delay.
Yeah. Because they either want to build in more things or they want to edit certain things. It does not look like, I'm not finding a date for
TBD.
That good old TBD.
TBD.
Gosh. I hate things with unreliable
September.
Release dates.
We're looking at September. It was supposed to be the end of July. It was supposed to be now. But it's now looking like September. And $35. I mean, is that enough? I mean, is that too much? What do you think?
It's the same cost as a Google Chrome app. Thing. What is it, Chromecast?
Yeah, Chromecast, yeah.
They kind of looks true. Like that, so it may, right?
I don't think it's too much, especially, I think no matter how cheap it was, a lot of people weren't going to buy it just because of how nerdy it is. Like, mm-hmm. to a certain extent, I feel like some people try to hide that they're playing the game. Like, I feel like...
You could put it in your pocket, though, right? This thing, or would you
have watch?
To wear it?
It's a watch.
Know.
It's a wrist thing.
Okay.
It's like a wrist. I wear it around my ankle.
It's watch-like. That's what everyone says. It's watch-like.
Well, from Tyler's demonstration earlier, I wasn't really sure where it goes.
It goes wherever you want it to go. Looking at it, it is pretty gaudy, tacky, whatever word you want to choose.
I clearly would have gone with gaudy. That's how I describe things all the time. Ugh, so gaudy.
Great word. It does look... It kind of has a teardrop look to it. Mm-hmm. I would assume most of our listeners have seen it.
Is it Velcro?
But it is. The watch, it looks like it clips on the watch. So the actual accessory itself, kind of a teardrop, maybe about an inch tall, half an inch wide.
It'd be
kind of
cool if you could pin it.
I think you can. What I'm looking at is it looks like it separates completely. So you might be able to, you know, put it in your pocket. If it's still, you just wanted to make sure that it measures your steps.
I think they should sell something like that that is specific to your team.
Yeah.
If it was some branded for your team, I think that would be the...
I have seen through, I think it was Etsy, I saw some people already making stickers to go over top so you can have your Team Instinct, of course.
Nice.
I would assume everyone's Team Instinct.
Team Instinct
is the best.
Some punk put a Team Valor poster up near where I work. I got to rip it down. I don't know who he thinks he is.
Yeah, that's just...
It's not going to happen.
I would assume it is more of an accessory than a watch, but it does come with a wrist strap that is blue, has Pokeballs on it. It looks canvassy. It looks very something I would have worn in second grade. Very.
Yeah, I think that they would sell more if they had something more discreet. You know, I think they'll sell a lot, but
I mean, it's you look at it, it's obviously
how popular
a Pokeball.
The game still is. If there's not some
very
sort of
true.
Update, I feel like the novelty will wear off for
it's
a lot of people.
It's already declining. I think
I believe that.
Yeah, I saw something yesterday that's talking about the players going less and less, which I mean, it's easy to believe. There's so much
not everybody
about
wants
it, so.
To be like
the very best
catching Pidgeys and Rattatas over and over again to level them up so you can hit the next level. Some people just want to be like, oh, look, there's a cute Squirtle.
Exactly.
I'm going
to
catch it.
Yeah, you're going to catch the ones you want to catch.
And then once you catch them, it's like, well, what am I doing anymore?
Now, at this point, only the original 151
are technically not all of them are even in. It's right now, there's five that are missing. So
right.
We're at 146.
Well, and certain ones are country locked, which is
six
pretty cool.
Missing.
Yeah.
That you can go to different countries to catch.
It's kind of annoying though, because we get Tauros in America, the one of the country locked ones that I care the least about.
Yes. By far.
He's got three tails though.
But yeah, but Kangaskhan is awesome.
There's literally a Pokemon.
But Kangaskhan has
tails.
One tail,
but also has a baby, so it's two Pokemon.
That's yeah, true. I mean, come on. But I think that's interesting. I think, you know, people who travel, if they can travel and get Wi-Fi, that this will be pretty cool for them. It is nice that those region locked Pokemon are available through eggs.
Are they?
Yes.
Because I've heard rumors, but I've hatched a lot of eggs and I've never seen one.
I read recently they are available, but okay. You're right. I know no one personally who has caught one.
Anyone who has a Mr. Mime, and I would assume maybe it's a very low drop.
It would have to be a low drop rate. So the what kind of things you think we'll see in an update? I would assume we've got one coming soon. It's been around a month. We've got reported glitches. We've got things like that. What do you guys think we're going to see in our first update?
All I ask is they fix the glitch.
Glitch fix should be the priority number one. I know they're talking about adding trading for sure. And I would think sooner or later they'll add in more Pokemon as we go. As the people who are mostly in it for the nostalgia kind of fade away, mm-hmm. and people who are in it because they like Pokemon stick around.
Catch more and more. We've got a new game coming out very soon.
Yeah.
A new full-on Pokemon game.
Yeah, Sun and Moon.
Any tie-ins there? Or will it be completely separate?
Ooh, that's a good question. I feel like they got to do something to hype that game, but I don't know if they would add Pokemon from that. Because I feel like if they want to continue any sort of nostalgia train, they got to go with Pokemon Gold and Silver next. Because that's probably where the game still had a decent following, you know, and then it kind of dropped off around third gen for most people.
Yeah, certainly. I would say it wasn't until they started re-releasing some of the older games on Game Boy Advance that even some younger players even picked up some of the originals. With all this Pokemon Go hype, I did have to pull out my Pikachu. What is it called?
Tamagotchi?
It really is. It's like a Pikachu Tamagotchi. It just says Pokemon Pikachu. Came out in 98. That it was it had a built-in pedometer. You could train your Pikachu.
That thing is cool.
That's Pokemon Go.
It really is. This is not new for Nintendo. This is something I feel like they've always wanted to create. It looks like those of you who haven't seen it, you got to look it up. It looks like a tiny yellow Game Boy. It's just called Pokemon Pikachu.
Tiny little Game Boy color right there.
And you can... shaking it. You can hear...
The pedometer in there.
Got to find some batteries to see if it still works. I don't remember much about it. I had it, but I don't remember much about it. It came out when Yellow came out, and I feel like there was a way where if you were wearing this, you could sync it up with your Game Boy Yellow game. I'm gonna have to look it up.
Gonna do some research.
But. If not, still, Tamagotchis were huge back then. I mean, I feel like everyone in my generation had one or knew someone who had one.
We're kind of different generations.
I know, you guys are just a couple years younger. But certainly this aspect is not new for Nintendo.
No, they even had in Pokemon Heart Gold and Soul Silver, they had the Pokewalker, which that came with the game that counted your steps, and you could train your Pokemon by stepping more and more. And in that, I think you could hatch eggs from
the street pass
in that too.
With the DS, the 3DS ones. Will 3DS. Certainly, I think, there's got to be some sort of connectivity.
Oh, there has to be.
Okay, final thoughts on Pokemon Go.
I think it's got a great core to it that needs to be built on. It's kind of like Destiny in its early days where the core is there and there's something about it that is... addictive, and I really enjoy playing it, even though I understand that it's a flawed game.
Yeah.
Kyle?
I think it's awesome. More things to come out to keep the hype going, you know, and keep people playing, but it's just such a... I love it right now because it's such a good thing for health, for mental health, getting people out of their house.
Dr.
Davidson.
But getting people walking is just such an underrated thing in health. You know, that's what... you tell patients that come in who are, you know, unhealthy patients, getting out and walking, getting them if they can afford a Fitbit even, those kind of things help so much. So to see something come out and affect the entire culture in America right now, getting people outside is just, it's great. And I think it's not underrated by any chance and by any means.
Certainly, certainly. I'm going to agree with both of you. I think it's got a great concept. I think the core is there. I'm really excited to see how it grows. And I think I'm actually more excited to see what other companies do with this idea, and how it maybe brings gaming into the reality and the real world just a little bit more. With you know, it doesn't even necessarily have to be augmented reality, seeing things through your camera, stuff like that. But the idea of playing affecting your real life could be really interesting. It sounds nerdy, but it could be really interesting. Listeners, thank you so much for sticking with us through this. Expect more updates as we work on this. Husky Raid Podcast, do we have any music to take us out? Insert music here.
Insert music. Follow us on Twitter.
Yes.
At Husky Raid Guys. You'll get updates. Remember those episodes are coming out, Destiny Cops?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we got some stuff going, and yeah.
Does anyone have any other projects that they want to pitch while they're here? Any?
Yeah, I do. I certainly do. I think that was, you were looking at me when you said that.
I thought I'd give you the opportunity.
No, I've got a blog that's been promoted on Husky Raid once or twice, streamsofhorror.com. Try to get a couple of horror movie reviews up there, specifically movies that are streaming on the various streaming websites. Sticking to Hulu, Amazon, and Netflix at the current time, because I think most people have those. And really, it's mostly Netflix, let's
mostly
be honest.
Netflix, yeah.
There's one Amazon review of Tusk.
Woo!
Yeah. Feel free, streamsofhorror.com. Husky Raid Guys on Twitter.
But if you're a horror movie fan, or you like, you know, scary movies, but you've seen some of them on Netflix and whatever, hit up Streams of Horror and you'll see some of the reviews. If you want a quick glance, he's got a thing for people who haven't seen it that are, it's spoiler
yes.
free.
Brief synopsis, movies that are in the same vein, or even shows that are in the same vein. There is a comment section. So far it's lonely and empty.
it's mostly just me commenting, you suck.
Yeah, it really is. And it's hurtful, but also constructive.
Yeah,
it's definitely constructive.
But it's great because, you know, horror movies, a lot of them are very unique. So you can go and see what you can pick what you want to watch after looking at his brief synopsis, and then watch it and then go and see what he's talking about with it. And I think it's a really cool thing.
Highly recommend it.
Thanks, yes. Guys. Aw.
For all of you that are old enough to watch horror movies that are listening.
Well, yeah. Husky Raid Podcast signing off. Thanks for listening.
Bye.